Thank you. Good evening, everyone. It's Alex Collins. Welcome to my tribute to Chick Corea here live from the Collective School of Music in New York City. Before I speak about Chick, I'd like to begin by playing a composition of his. This tune is entitled Love Castle. Hope you like it. So the tune I just played was a composition of Chick Corea from my favorite album of his, and that record was entitled My Spanish Heart. That came out in, I believe, 1976, and it was a wonderful fusion record that he played, and he had his wife, Gail Moran, singing all these different choral parts. So let's go back to the beginning. Let's start from the beginning of who Chick Corea was. So Chick Corea was born in 1941 in Boston, well, actually Chelsea, Massachusetts, which is a suburb of Boston. And he grew up in a musical household. His dad was a Dixieland trumpet player, and Chick was exposed to jazz music early on. He was exposed to the bebop masters such as Charlie Parker, Dizzy Gillespie, Bud Powell, Horace Silver, just to name a few. So music was in his bones from a very early age. His real name is actually Armando Corea. Chick, as you may have figured, is a nickname. So many people might wonder, well, how did Chick Corea get the nickname Chick? Well, I read that when he was a kid, his aunt used to pinch his cheeks and call him Cheeky. And that got shortened and turned into Chick. So it actually comes from Cheeky. And he became named Chick Corea as we know him. So when Chick was of the age ready to go to college, he decided that he wanted to study music. So he quickly went, briefly, he went to Columbia University and studied music there before transferring to Juilliard and studying there before dropping out of college altogether to go on the road. And his first major gig, believe it or not, was with Cab Calloway. So Cab Calloway, for those that don't know him, was a swinging singer who was best known for his piece Minnie the Moocher. So imagine Chick Corea playing Minnie the Moocher. Think about that for a second. I don't think we think about Chick that way. Now, who was Chick as a musician? So Chick as a musician was a post-bebop pianist at the beginning of his career, but he ended up engaging in styles of fusion and avant-garde music, melodic music, Spanish music. And what makes Chick so special is that he played so many styles of music and integrated those styles of music into his own playing. He really didn't have boundaries in the sense, like a lot of other great musicians do have some form of boundaries. Now, whether boundaries are good or bad, that's not an issue. It's just more what made Chick special to me was that he was an innovator and he was open to blending different styles of music together. I had a piano teacher in college, Harold Danko, and he said to me that he took a lesson with Chick once. And he said that Chick said to him, don't be afraid to just open up any piece of classical music or any style of music and play through it and find something that you like and then integrate it into your own playing. So it was really, when I heard Chick, I always heard so many styles and he had so many different projects that he had going on, whether it was the famous ones like Return to Forever, you know, or the trio with Roy Haynes, or the duos that he did with Bobby McFerrin, or Gary Burton, all those wonderful vibraphone duos. So he really had a lot of different things, and he kept many of them going throughout his life. It's not like he stopped one thing and started another thing. A lot of these bands kept coming back. Towards the end of his career, he would even play at the Blue Note for many weeks in a row, and each week he would have a different band and a different sound. So there was never a shortage of creativity with Chick Corea. So now, what I'm gonna do is I'm actually gonna go all the way back to early in Chick Corea's career to his first record that he recorded, which was Tones for Jones Bones was the name of the record. And it came out in 1967, okay? So I like to divide Chick Corea's career into, for the 60s and 70s, which is primarily what I'll be focusing on today. I like to categorize it as pre-Miles Davis Quintet, the years that he did with the Miles Davis group and post the years that he did with the Miles Davis group. So this is before he was in Miles Davis's band. Okay, so this tune is entitled Straight Up and Down, and again, it's from his record Tones for Jones Bone. So here's a little bit of that. So that was Straight Up and Down, which was an early composition of Chick Corea. So let's check out a little bit about what the key sounds in that piece were that made it sound of that time rather than modern Chick Corea. So the first thing that made this piece very noticeable, if you notice when I was soloing, he would have these three-note chords in the left hand. He would have them. They would be called chordal voicings, meaning in fourths. So Q-U-A-R-T-A-L, chordal. So check this out. Now, what he would do in his right hand, compared to more old school bebop pianists, he would do something a little different. So first I'm going to show you what a bebop pianist would do. Okay? So a bebop pianist, if they were playing an F minor chord, like an F minor 7, they'd play something like this. The chords would be more closed, and like this, and in the right hand they'd play some ideas like this. So there are these chromatic ideas. Now by that I mean notes with a lot of half steps, small movements between the notes. But what Chick Corea would do, he'd do something different. So he would have these voicings in the left hand, and in the right hand he'd have something called pentatonics. What are pentatonics? What does that word even mean? A pentatonic scale is a scale with five notes. you think of a pentagon. A pentagon is a shape with five sides. So a pentatonic scale is simply a scale with five notes. And there are many different pentatonics. So what does a pentatonic sound like? But Chick, when he played at these tempos, he'd make it sound nice and pointy. Okay? So you've got these pentatonic scales, and he'd do variations on them. Take everything I say not as a rule, but as an idea of something he would be using to create his improvisations and his jazz lines. So now we have these pentatonic ideas and we have these fourth voicings. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to integrate these pentatonics with the fourth voicings. Let's hear what that sounds like. Okay? But he would also have ideas that were not just pentatonic ideas, but they were basically similar to the fourth voicings in his left hand. These voicings, right? But he would play them, these notes individually in his right hand, okay? So this is the note, this is the voicing in the left hand. He might arpeggiate it in the right hand. Now, what he's gonna do is he's gonna take that pentatonic voicing, those pentatonic scales, and he's gonna blend them with these chordal voicings and these chordal arpeggios. Let's see what that sounds like. Okay, so the next thing that he would do in there, if that's not already a lot of stuff, he would do something called parallel harmony. What is parallel harmony? Okay, so he would take one of these chords and he'd measure the distances and he'd move all of these notes up the same exact distances. Or he'd move them down the same exact distances. So if I were to move parallel harmony in whole tones, it would sound something like this. So if the bass player kept the note F, it would sound like this. So this sound, this was 1967, okay? So around that time, McCoy Tyner had recorded The Real McCoy, and McCoy Tyner was one of the first people to get this sound going. So it was in the jazz scene at the time. The sound was very prominent, and Chick Corea and McCoy Tyner, McCoy Tyner is a very famous piano player. He also recently passed away. And McCoy Tyner was 3 years older than Chick Corea. So this sound at that time, that very fourth-ish, was very prominent in the music. And you can hear that in Chick's playing. So when you move a year later, 1968, Chick Corea ends up releasing a record called Now He Sings, Now He Sobs, which was with Roy Haynes on the drums and Miroslav Vitus on the bass. Okay, now this takes that sound that you heard on that first tune, but it takes it and makes it a little more out there, a little more avant-garde. He does some things to make it a little bit different. So I'm going to play you a tune from Now He Sings, Now He Sobs. This is an offshoot of a minor blues, and it's entitled Steps. And this, of course, is a Chick Corea composition. Thank you. Cool. So that was a bit of Steps, which was the first track on his record, Now He Sings, Now He Sobs, with Miroslav Vitus and Roy Haynes. So now what he did on this record, which is a little different, is he would try to do things that involved getting away from pure consonants. What is consonants compared to dissonance? Consonance means it sounds really pretty. Dissonance means there's harmonic friction that makes it hurt the ears, so to speak. Not necessarily hurt the ears, but let's put it this way, make the ears work to listen. And consonance just makes it sound really pretty. So, in the consonant context of what he was doing on this tune, he might play a basic pentatonic scale over this chord, and it would sound pretty. But sometimes he would want to create some sort of friction. So what are some tools that he might use to create some friction? So the first thing that one could do is you could do something called a sidestep. Okay, that's basically taking something in the left hand and moving it to the right or moving it to the left. So if C minor is here, he might imply a C sharp minor even though the bass player is still playing a C. So that would sound like this. But he also might imply that in the right hand, right? So he might try to create dissonance on the right hand. So if the left hand stayed the same and the right hand changed, it would sound like this. Okay? Now if the left hand moved and the right hand stayed the same, it would sound like this. So now, but the way he would do it, one thing he would do is in addition to those pentatonic scales, he'd have this little diminished cluster that he would do, which would be this. And the diminished cluster would be something to kind of create a difference between the consonants, something that really kind of created some push and pull, you know, a tug of war between the dissonance and the consonants. So here would be what something would sound like when he played on that. Right? So did that, it would sound, when you put them together, it would sound like this. Slow it down so you can see it slower. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. So those were textures that he used on that record, Now He Sings, Now He Sobs, and on obviously that tune, Steps. So after that record, he may have recorded something before, but he ended up in Miles Davis's band from 1968 to 1970. So a little context about that. Prior to Chick Corea entering Miles Davis's band, which when Chick entered, it became purely electric. It was an electric band at that point. Prior to that, Herbie Hancock was the pianist. So Herbie Hancock was the pianist with Miles Davis from 1963 to 1968. And that was that famous band with Ron Carter, Tony Williams, Miles Davis. George Coleman was in the band from 63 to 64. And Wayne Shorter from 65. Into 69 a little bit, I believe. And anyway, so when Chick entered that band, I believe Dave Holland was in there. Anyway, he did a few records with Miles Davis, many of which had two keyboards. So there was live at the, he did Philly's Day, Kilimanjaro, In a Silent Way, Bitches Brew, live at the Fillmore East, and live at the Fillmore West. And I believe Bitches Brew on many tracks had multiple keyboard players, multiple drummers, and one of the drummers that he ended up working with quite a bit later on was on Bitches Brew with him, Lenny White, master drummer, wonderful musician. And so a lot of these bands that he was in with Miles Davis had two keyboards. I don't necessarily know how that affected his playing after, but it is interesting. And during that time, on Live at the Fillmore East, he was playing electric piano, and the other electric pianist on the same gig was Keith Jarrett. So imagine that. You had like two of the greatest masters that ever lived playing piano together at the same time. And Live at the Fillmore West was just Chick. And I remember that somebody told me a funny story. I'm thinking the record was Live at the Fillmore West. Somebody said they had met Chick one time and they said, "Hey Chick, you played this thing. I think it was Live at the Fillmore West. The most amazing thing I ever heard. What was it? I mean, it was like you played like this swell of ideas. It was so great. It was so unbelievable." He said, "Do you remember the track? I think it was," we'll just say for the point of the story, "I think it was Directions." And Chick says back to the guy, says, "Oh, I remember that. Yeah, I spilled Coca-Cola on the Fender Rhodes and I had to wipe it off." And so someone was trying to transcribe an idea of Chick, but the idea was actually not something he meant to play. It was due to wiping off spilled Coca-Cola on the Fender Rhodes. I just thought that was an interesting anecdote I wanted to share. So one of the most famous bands that Chick formed was after Miles Davis, and that was a band of his called Return to Forever. Okay, so Return to Forever was, there were actually a couple of main Return to Forever bands. So the first one was, I believe, in post 1970, and that was with Flora Purim, Joe Farrell, Stanley Clark, and Ayerto Morera. Ayerto, he also, I think, met on Bitches Brew with Miles Davis. So, natural segue. And that was the first band, and that was, I believe, they finished 72, maybe 73. And then the second Return to Forever, which was from 1973 to 76, was with Lenny White and Stanley Clark and Al Di Meola. So the one with Lenny White, Al Di Meola, and Stanley Clark, that was a fusion band. While the first band with Flora Purim, Stanley Clark, Ayerto, and Joe Farrell, that was more an acoustic band. So two different sounds. Both incredible, by the way. But you start to hear when he does Light as a Feather that idea, even though the band was acoustic, he was still playing a Fender Rhodes. When I say electric, I'm more referring to synthesizers. I still consider Fender Rhodes on the side of acoustic. But he definitely, I think, post Miles Davis's band, became more open to integrating genres that weren't purely traditional jazz. And I think the 70s for a lot of artists were really good like that. I mean, you think about Miles did that, so obviously Chick was highly influenced by Miles, and the fact that Miles was a very eclectic musician himself, always looking for something new and to not get caught in something from yesterday. Of course, all the things of the past have their merit and they're wonderful, but these guys were innovators and they moved the music forward. So in the 70s, you know, you had Herbie Hancock and the Headhunters band, Miles Davis's stuff, Chick Corea stuff, which we're about to get into in the 70s. So a lot of really amazing music. So a tune I'm gonna play for you right now is one of the compositions from Chick Corea's Light as a Feather record, which I love. And This tune is entitled Spain, and it's actually co-written by a Spanish classical composer named Joaquin Rodrigo. And so it's entitled Spain. Hope you like it. Thank you. So that was Spain from Chick Corea's Light as a Feather record. And one of my favorite compositions. It's interesting. Chick really had a real interest in Spanish music. And it certainly came across in the tune called Spain. So there were certain elements to me that made this have that Spanish sound and the harmony. So let's check out some key things that kind of make it sound Spanish. Okay. So I have this G major chord. So right here, that sequence from that G major to that F sharp has a Spanish flair to it. Now, in the traditional context, we'd probably expect it to go here, which it does later on in the piece. But Chick doesn't give that away right away. So when you hear this, again, we're expecting this, but that's very final sounding. So what Chick does to make it sound interesting is he plays that first chord. But now, he transfers to the relative major. So for those of you who aren't musicians that are watching, what is the relative major? So in music, we have something called a key signature, and a key signature makes it easy to understand where home base is, you know. So when I say home base, I mean, if we're in the key of C major, there's something on the paper that tells us we're in C major. So wherever we go, we know home base is C major. But in this piece, the home base is B minor. So one minor key and one major key always share the same key signature, okay? So if you're in minor, the major key that shared the same key signature as the minor key would be called the relative major. And if you're in major, the minor key that shares that key would be called the relative minor, okay? So if we're in B minor, and then we go to D major is the relative major of B minor. So he's playing with that idea and going between sad, very, I would say a darker color mixed with a lighter color. And he does this so well, where he kind of balances these dark colors with these lighter colors, that he takes you on a journey, you know? And so I love this era of Chick's music, because now, while I loved the old era, of course, it's amazing, and it's jazz, this is something else. This is almost, it creates scenes in my head of different things, and I, of course, can see what my vision would be of Spain, because the music is so expressive of a place. So we have major. We do a little 2-5 progression to the major. When I say 2-5 to a non-musician, it's a group of chords that helps us get to a certain chord. Okay, so I won't explain all the theoretical things of what make a 2-5, but it basically, it allows us to go from somewhere to somewhere else, okay? So, now we're going back to minor again. But he doesn't give us minor, actually, he gives us major. So you think it's gonna be final, but it's not. He's saying there's still more. Then after that, what happens? He goes to another section. Now when he gets to this next section, this is an upbeat section that technically doesn't have a chord underneath it, but it has kind of an E minor vibe, and it's this section. So what he does on the recording is He plays this figure, and there are hand claps going in the background. I don't think I have the... Let's see, maybe I could do it, maybe we can do it. So it gives it this whole energy. So he has these hand claps going, and then he has these people making like, making sounds, like speaking. It's really hip. So he was really pulling from so many different colors on that track, which was different than the earlier tracks, which to me were much more jazz. So at this point, I feel like Chick had made another great contribution in addition to having already proved himself as an amazing jazz pianist. Now he was proving to be a visionary composer blending genres together. So that band who did Spain lasted until, I believe, either the end of 72 or early 73, because the next Return to Forever band, which was with Aldi Meola, Stanley Clark, and Lenny White, was from 73 to 76. And that band was much more electric, a lot of synthesizers, real electric. I had the privilege to work with Lenny White, the drummer for that band, a few times. He's a real master, and he would always want me to really explore different textures with multiple synthesizers at the same time, which was what Chick was really such a master at during that time. And so it's really interesting to hear Chick's synth work later on in the mid-70s, because he was a rarity in that he was such a brilliant acoustic pianist, but he was also a brilliant electric pianist, and he could do multiple things at the same time. He could go from acoustic piano to synthesizers to maybe a Moog type synth up top, and he could keep that going and then go back to the acoustic, maybe one hand at this part of the piano, one hand on the synthesizer. I mean, a real genius. So what a treat to hear him. So next up, he did this record in 1976, which was called My Spanish Heart. My Spanish Heart is my favorite Chick Corea record. I have other favorites too. It's not like I think this is the best one. It just happens to be my favorite one. And nothing really demonstrates the brilliance of that Spanish sound integrated into jazz better than My Spanish Heart. So in Love Castle, which I played earlier, he has a few things that he does to make the sound so interesting. So in Love Castle, since I already played it, I'm just gonna kind of demonstrate a little bit before I continue. He does this thing where key things that he did to create that Spanish sound was he had something I like to think of as it's a parallel movement of a major chord. Okay, so what does that mean? And if you don't know all this theoretical stuff, what it means is I take this chord, an A major, move each finger up the same distance to another major chord, B flat. Okay, so now you have this kind of here. Okay, so that's one thing that he uses to create that Spanish sound. Then, the other thing on My Spanish Heart, which I'll show you in the next piece I'm going to play, is he has this ascending kind of quality to a lot of his pieces. So, in Love Castle, which I played earlier, so this. So this is a quality, I don't know if this is a Spanish quality, but it's certainly a a classical quality, and a lot of the music that he checked out was Spanish classical. So there's some classical elements as well. And in Armando's Rumba, which I'm about to play, he does something like this. So there definitely was this ascending quality to his pieces. Very, so this record, My Spanish Heart, is extremely melodic. It's got acoustic elements, it's got synthesizer elements, it's got fusion elements. So now he's got all these different genres entering. He's got a choir, which is led, the vocals are primarily by his wife, Gail Moran, who was his wife then, I think, and his wife until he passed away. She's singing all the vocal parts. He's got a string quartet on there. He's got hand claps. And then, of course, he's got the traditional rhythm sections. So he's really pulling from so many different things. I also think that Chick was somebody like Miles Davis in this sense. So Miles Davis was someone that always was influenced by the band members around him. He understood how to put the right people in a room and play with them. And when Miles Davis played with people, he would always put these bands together and he would evolve with the band. He knew that if you want to keep evolving, eventually you need to switch up the band. And Chick, to me, had so many different bands that he played with and created new sounds with. And I'm only focusing on a few today because we only have an hour. But with Chick, there were so many bands that he worked with that I didn't mention. So a couple of them were this avant-garde band in 1970 and 71 called Circle with Anthony Braxton, Dave Holland, and Barry Altschul, okay? So this was the most out, I would guess. By out, by the way, I mean dissonant. This is the most out that I think Chick Corea would probably get commercially in terms of recordings. I think after he hit Return to Forever, he tried to keep the music a little more mainstream. Although there were some records that weren't so mainstream, like The Leprechaun. There were some elements of Mad Hatter. Anyway, so he had other projects that were really interesting in terms of how he blended genres. So one project he had was a duo project where they did a bunch of records with Gary Burton. Gary Burton was a famous vibraphone player. Another project that I love was the one he did with the singer Bobby McFerrin. So for those of you who don't know who Bobby McFerrin is, he is one of the most incredible singers and can do all sorts of, in addition to just being a brilliant vocalist, he can do all sorts of percussive sounds with his voice. He can sound like a trumpet. He could sound like a drum. He could sound like a saxophone, and he can sing super high, super low, great falsetto, great full voice. And with Bobby McFerrin, I heard them do a tune that I'm about to play for you, and I also heard this tune in My Spanish Heart, and they would do all sorts of textures. Sometimes Bobby McFerrin would be the bass while Chick Corea would just be playing melodies. Then Chick would be the bass while Bobby McFerrin would play melodies. So Chick was just so open to finding, I think, to being resourceful. Two, I think to finding all the strengths and the great qualities of all the musicians he worked with, and one, bringing them out in those people, and two, allowing them to bring something new out in him. And I think that's so important as any musician, really, but especially an improvisational musician. When you're playing with other people, it's about the that collective energy of different people getting together and kind of creating something that's unique to the energy of that particular group. And I think nobody did that better than Chick and Miles Davis. So I'm gonna play now a tune
from My Spanish Heart, one of my favorites, and also from, he also did a take live with Bobby McFerrin that was beautiful. So anyway, this tune is entitled Armando's Rumba. Hope you like it. So that tune was entitled Armando's Rumba. I hope you enjoyed today's tribute to Chick Corea, and I hope you learned a little bit about him, and hopefully you can check out some of his records. There are so many great ones. If you're wondering where to start,
with Chick, I'm going to recommend you to my favorite record, My Spanish Heart, but there's a lot. So really hope you enjoyed today's masterclass and performance. So there are, just so you know, there are more events coming up at the Collective. There's more stuff online as well. So check in about that. And once again, my name is Alex Collins. Thank you so much, and hope you have a good night.